minutes. I got a suggestion here that I should address a little short video that someone in Los Angeles made against me, thinking he makes it against me, but he makes it against Hashem, because everything he claims in a video is basically words against Hashem. It's always easier to blame the speaker. So we'll address, I never saw the video, but from what I understand, I'll try to address what they speak about. Interested. Make up an excuse. I'm not interested. I want to be whatever I want to be. Leave me alone. I would respect you a lot more. Why to come with excuses and take things out of context and try to prove the speaker wrong? That's not the right way. The right way is to say, everything you say is really written, is not making it up. I'm not interested in it. If that's the religion, I don't want to keep it. Oh, at least you're honest. You failing in your mission in life, but at least you're honest. The Hashem say to people like that, not talking people who make movies and try to ruin the reputation of someone who saved souls for 20 years. I'm not talking about the punishment of this person, which is endless. I'm talking about someone that just say, lo chatati. Forget about influence other people to be criminals. No, I'm not talking about machti arabim. Machti arabim, the Torah say, en maspikim biyado lasot tshuva. Even if he wants to make repentance, Hashem puts an X on him. Once you influence so many thousands of people not to come to the lectures, not to listen, not to make tshuva, by giving them all kinds of false information, then every sin they make comes to your account. When are you going to fix it? Not to talk about that you spill the blood of a kosher person. I don't know what was in the mind of this person who made this video. I feel very bad for him. I tell you the truth. Because what he have done, if he live a million years, he won't be able to correct. A million years. With fasting every day. There's no end to it, such thing. There's really no end to it. And it's not up to me to forgive him. I can forgive him right now, 100%. It's not even my issue. I didn't write the Torah. Hashem will never forgive him. Why? Because the damage that he made will constantly grow. It's not something that you say, okay, I made a mistake. Thank you. I apologize. Forgive me. Here's a $100 donation. That's it. I'm backing up. It's not working this way. It's continued to travel the damage. It will travel for the next 10 years. Who knows how many kids will become Chalel Shabbat from it? Who knows how many people should have listened to the lectures and become stronger? Now they're not interested because they have something bad in their mind. And these people would marry non-Jews in the end, and it's all going to be his responsibility. He's going to have to pay for every one of their sins for the next 1,000 years. As long as this world exists, even for the grandchildren of them, he's going to pay. Now, just to understand what he did to himself, this person. I feel very bad for him. I don't want to see any Jew get destroyed. It's the last thing I want. Obviously, what I do is try to save souls, not, chas v'shalom, bury them. So we go back to what we say. There are three things. There's anything else that they said? And I never watched the video, so I don't really know. There's few points that they say. Anything else that we should address?
Where is the YouTube?
YouTube.
But what is the address?
I don't know. I didn't watch it.
What's the point?
It's interesting.
So I think, yeah, with Mechalel Shabbat, the mixed dancing, and the autistic kids, I think that was just it, no? Maybe there was one more thing which I don't remember. This is just an answer, not for this Rasha that made the film, no. He doesn't deserve even to talk to him. It's for the people that may get fooled by it. Now it's in a separate advice that I give you. Never believe any video, forget about me, any video that someone show you, supposedly a negative video, and it's only a few minutes, never believe it. Watch the entire lecture. Why? I'll give you an example. One guy one time sent me an email. What do you have against Satmer? He said, I love your lectures very much, but what do you have against Satmer? I said, what made you think I have anything against Satmer? He said, I heard you've been in this lecture and you say such and such. I said to him, go now listen to the whole lecture and then call me right back. After the lecture, he said, wow, I'm so ashamed. You basically praise them nonstop. The things that they did. You made some comments that it's 100% true. In the time of the Holocaust, well, maybe the world is different today, but just for us to know, in the time of the Holocaust, when the Nazis took all the Jewish girls to the gas chambers, so before they put them in the gas chambers, obviously everyone took their clothes off. So the men were standing on one side and the women on another side. The Nazis made separation. Men separate, women separate. The Nazis did everything they can do to humiliate the Jews, as everyone knows. Not only to kill them, not only to torture them, mentally to torture them, mentally. So what could be a bigger humiliation taking religious men and religious rebbitzen and put them naked together, all like sardines in one place? It's a very big thing, but even that they did not do. They put the men naked on one side, they took the lady naked on another side. But there were two kinds of Jewish ladies. There were the religious one and the secular one. And the Nazis took pictures of everything they do, as you can see today in the museums. So 5 minutes before they put them in a gas chambers, 5 minutes, a woman is standing, she sees the smoke coming, she knows she's going there now. So there were two kinds of groups. The religious groups, they know they're going to die now. They all gather together, they attach to each other, they turn their face inside, that when the Nazi come to take picture, they won't be able to take a picture of one of them, not naked. So they turn like this, as much as they can, to cover each other, and they put their head that they won't see any one of their picture, that her picture naked will never be ever in a history presented anywhere. She's going to die, but she cares more about her dignity as a woman. But the secular women, they stand like this, completely in front of the photographer, they're crying that they're going to die. So they're thinking about, I don't want to die. Who cares? Puts my picture all over the world. This is the difference between a person that has God in his life and a person who doesn't have God in his life. Person that has God and knows Torah and knows the purpose of life, you know, okay, I'm dying. One way or the other, we die anyway. One day we'll die. We're not going to be here forever. The question is, how are we going to die? I'm going to die as a proud Jew, as a righteous Jew, as a servant of Hashem, with dignity, and I'm going to where Hashem promised for the righteous people to go, or I'm going to die and will be memorized as Chas v'Shalom in the worst humiliation that possible. Person, think about his spirituality. Everything will be clear. Right now, almost nothing is clear. Why a flat tire? You don't know. Why your best friend is a big tzaddik and he has cancer? It's an epidemic now. Every day there's more cancer cases than yesterday. If it continues like this, in a few years from now, it'll be almost every person. You have no idea what's going on here. Nobody knows what's the root of it. The answer is, I don't understand. It's in the Torah. I will bring you the machala mam'eret. The Torah says, machala, that it spreads in the body. V'ishlich b'cha et ha-me'era. Ma ze me'era? Machala mam'eret. That it expands, it spans, it takes away all the body. It's in the Torah. 67 years ago, do you remember one cancer case? When I was a kid, nobody knew what it is. Even 40 years ago, it was very rare. Now, every 3, 4, 5, 10 minutes without a text, it's already a miracle. So what's going to be in the end? Everyone will get it? You have no idea what's going on here. Now, when a person is addicted to the internet, what is he usually makes in the internet scenes? He watches dirty movies. So today they published on the news that all these dirty movies website, they have inside of their dirty movies viruses that take pictures of the person who look at that. And then they come and blackmail him. I was so happy. I said, Shtabach Shemo, you couldn't do it 10 years ago, 20 years ago. Why? Now every person who wants to go make these scenes who take him completely away from Hashem is going to think a million times. You're going to watch a dirty movie, 5-10 minutes. 2 days later, a letter. Send $100,000 to this P.O. box. If not, you were on Sunday between 2 and 2:30 watching this dirty movie and this website. We have all your pictures and the whole world. They turn the camera of the computer on and they film the person the entire time when he watched the dirty movie. And they blackmail him. And then they show it to the whole world, just like in a judgment day. So Hashem wanted to give us a taste how it's going to feel in a judgment day, in case you didn't believe. Ein Roah, ואוזן שומעת, וכל מעשיך בספר נכתב. I was so happy. Really, I couldn't wipe the smile out of my face. So השתבח שמו. Finally, there's a chance to win the יצר הרע in this world. Every other guy today, I get email, I have this problem, what should I do? What are you going to do? Learn Torah. No, I can't learn Torah. What are you going to tell this guy? This is what's destroying the world today. Example, today we have a very common problem with our youth. What's the problem? First of all, not everyone religious, we understand. So, some people becoming religious. Now they go on a date. After a date or two, they cannot hold themselves. Now they decided that they really want each other. They see chemistry. They see some love is being created. And he's thinking, that's going to be my wife. And she's thinking, I'm going to marry this guy. And what happened? Instead of holding themselves 2, 3, 4 months until they finally become legally married, they begin to touch each other. He holds her hand, and a little bit, you know, her arm, or he walks with her on the street, so he touches her back a little bit. So he's thinking, God doesn't care about touching her hand. Well, come on, it's not Iran here. It's the 21st century here. But surprisingly, it always starts with the hand, and the next day it's the arm, and then it's the shoulder, and then it's the face, and then she has to become a murderer when she makes an abortion 2, 3 months later. What made her murderer and him, both of them? What made them murderers? That he puts his hand on her hand for the first time. If he would listen to God not to touch her, or she would listen to God not to let any man touch her until her wedding, not to talk about the future will be beautiful and everything in her marriage will be fantastic with great harmony and peace, because God would be so proud of this modest girl that she listens to me and she didn't let a man touch her until she became officially a kala, a wife. Of course I'm going to bless her. What's the question? What, I'm going to punish her for holding her desire not to go and make sin and let any man touch her? Of course, she's going to get the best blessing. What do you think? You do what God told you and you get punished for it? What's going on here? Why people come to the wrong conclusion? Let's call Shomer Negiah. Watching that nobody touch you. She has red lines. She never let a man make a full sin with her. Of course, nah, Rabbi, come on. Nah. It's in our family, you know. We were very observant. My father will kill me if he find out. But she doesn't understand that all the full sins that ended up very bitter started with a little touch and a hug and then a little kiss, and then it leads to things that's it. They cannot control themselves. And even if it didn't end with a murder or an abortion or anything like this, or a horrible disease or who knows what, once they finally get married, even not to each other, each one separately, she went in the end marry another guy, and he went and marry another girl, they're going to suffer for the rest of their life for these sins. You cannot get away with that. Because you started it corrupted, rotten, the foundation of your life is rotten, it's not stable, you suffer for the rest. You cannot build 100 floors on foundations that are weak or crooked. Not many of you knows that the previous Pope that resigned, the reason that he resigned is not me, but it's Judaism. It's Rav Yaakov Ades. There's a big tzaddik in Yerushalayim that wrote a book, and they translated it to English, to Italian, and he sent it to Rome, and somebody gave it to the Pope, and the Pope sent them a secret letter that after he read this book, it doesn't give him rest. And shortly after, a few weeks later, he resigned. First time in history, I believe, that a Pope resigned in his job. You understand why? The evidence is so solid, you have to close your eyes and pretend you're blind to continue to follow it. Some mitzvot has good luck. For instance, mezuzah. Mezuzah, almost every Jew in the world has mezuzah. Even Jews that do not believe in Hashem, chas v'shalom, somehow put mezuzah. Sometimes I go to places, Manhattan, The people don't know. They ask him about Hashem. Oh, I don't know. I'm not sure. This, oh, all the house mezuzot. Or Brit Milah. It's mitzvah with mazal. When people don't know Torah, life is very difficult. Ignorance is the biggest enemy of a person. Most of the Jews are wicked, reshaim, not because they bad people. Most of the Jews I meet, really nice people, good heart. You can see sometimes they have tears, they have feelings. You need help, they come to help. Bemet, most of them. Yeah, there's always evil people in the world. Most of them are good people. So why they go against Hashem? Sometimes people say to me, you know, Rabbi is not religious, but he's a good man. You're not allowed to say it. If a person is good to everyone and is not good to his creator, to Hashem that gives him oxygen and money and health, how can you call him a good person? The opposite, if he's good to everyone and not good to Hashem, is worse than someone that is bad to everyone. Someone that is bad to everyone, that's his nature. Poor guy, he's an evil person. He doesn't like anyone and nobody likes him. But someone who is nice to everyone and he spit in Hashem's face is much worse than the other one. Because the other one is bad, this is his nature. But you, when you want, you can be a very nice person. So why are you nice to everyone and you don't appreciate what I did for you? I gave you a house. Who gave you the house? I gave you. Gave you money, gave you clothing, gave you a wife, gave you children, gave you a table, gave you a car, gave you everything you have, I give you. I take care of you, I save you, I make your whole system work in a body. And what do you do in the end? Can we save $10 on the meat? Mm-hmm. Okay, let's buy. Over here, you see what the religious people? $10 a pound. Thieves! The rabbis, they like to steal. Why? You, do you understand the difference between animal that they put with electric and they kill the animal to an animal that they slaughter and they clean and they put salt? You understand? It's 10 times more work here. And it's only 20-30% more on the price. Technically, it should have been 10 times more. You know how the goyim eat? When you eat non-kosher meat, you know what you eat? Let me tell you what you eat next time you really enjoy it. They have 500 cows. They stand on a floor that is made from metal. Metal. They take the voltage, 500 volt. 1 minute, all the cows die and they fall. Like this, 3 days. One by one, they take sword, open it, take the skin off, cut the head off. But in the meantime, the cows is there 10 hours, 20 hours, like this, all day. So they put cold, it's in the refrigerator there, but they there. Now what happened in the meantime? The stomach of the cow is full of pee. All the pee that the cow goes is 5 liters. You can fill up a whole thing. And all the blood, everything stay in the body for 10, 20 hours. It's marinates the meat. It's absorbed inside the meat. So the meat is very juicy. Very juicy with what? With the bathroom of the cow. You eat meat. Imagine your baby made, 2 years old baby made in a bucket. And you take the meat now that you want to do for Shabbos and you put inside your baby's pee for 10 hours overnight. And then you put it in a chulent. It's delicious. But if somebody know what you did to the meat, they vomit. When you go to a non-kosher restaurant, that's what you eat. That's why the meat is a little bit juicier. Why? They don't put salt right away. They don't slather and put salt. They leave all the liquid inside the cow for 20 hours. By the time you eat it, it's delicious, but it's poison. You understand why we're not allowed to eat pig? Do you know? Why? The goyim eat pig. The Russian loves pig. They eat pig for morning, for lunch, breakfast, every day. So why? Every animal we eat, it takes 4 hours to digest. One animal, it takes 24 hours to digest the pig. 24 hours in the stomach of a pig. Now the pig eats everything. You put the bathroom, you take from the bathroom everything, you put in front of the pig, he eats. You take the diapers of your baby, you put, the pigs eat. You take a dead rat, a dead dog, everything you put, the pigs eat. Everything. You put tablecloth, the pigs eat. Everything goes to the garbage, he eats everything. Everything, when they kill the pig, everything is in the stomach, all the germs, all the dirt for 24 hours because he didn't digest it yet. So it's the worst thing. It's very unhealthy. And Hashem said, don't touch this. It's a filthy animal. But they eat, they lick it. Oh, pork chops. They only knew what they eat. They vomit just by looking at that. However, the cow, the sheep, Don't eat any garbage, only grass. Very, very vegetarian. No dead rats, no diapers, nothing. What the cow eats? Only grass, minerals, healthy, 100%. Did you ever think how a cow became so fat from grass? Where the fat comes from? They only eat grass. The deer, it's kosher. What the deer eat? Leaves. Leaves. No problem. Don't eat any germs, nothing whatsoever. That's why, and also Hashem say all the kosher animals, it's animals that are not murderers. The deer do not murder. The cow do not murder. The sheep do not murder. The giraffe is kosher, it does not murder. The bison is kosher, does not murder. Lion, tiger, all these animals, it's all murderers. We're not allowed to eat murderers. Same thing by the birds. There's 19 birds in the Parashat Shmini, they're all murderers. The murderers, not kosher. All the other ones, kosher. Hashem doesn't want us to be like them. You eat them, you become like them. So Hashem say, you eat only animals who surrender. And also when Hashem say to sacrifice in Bet HaMikdash animals, giraffe is kosher, but you're not allowed to sacrifice giraffe. Why? It will take 3 days to catch it, to bring it, to slaughter it. You need a ladder. You fall, the giraffe moves. You fall, you break your head. Hashem say, I know it's difficult. You don't need giraffe. Deer, you don't sacrifice. Why? It's very difficult to catch a deer. Hashem say, when I finally told you to do mitzvah, I gave you the easiest mitzvah. Who? Cow and sheep. You don't need to run. You take it and you bring it to the Beit HaMikdash. But up to then, you go Germany, Poland, everyone was religious. All of a sudden, started to go to colleges, to become like the Goyim. In 100 years, almost all the Jews became Goyim, and Hashem brought the Nazis and killed almost everyone. Because they left the Shabbat and left the Torah. But by the Arab countries, everyone was religious. No Hitler, no Holocaust. But in two places, the Jews also became like Goyim. Where? Greece and Tunisia, the Italians, the Tripoli, Libya and Tunisia, the Iraqi and the Libya, the Italians and the French already came there and they made it like Europe, and many of the Jews started to become like them. 60,000 here, 70,000 there got killed. Sephardic Jews. But in Syria, nobody. Egypt, nobody. Iran, no one. Iraq, why? All the Jews kept Shabbat 100%. You didn't find all these years what we have today. Today you go to some countries, even now in Yemen. You know Yemen, Yemenite Jew? Did you ever know that in Yemen, until this day, not one time in history, one Yemenite Jew ever was mechalel Shabbat? From 2,600 years ago until today, in the land of Yemen, not even one time. There was one Jew even that was mechalel Shabbat. Never. Not one. Even now, today, you don't have one. You know why? They didn't have internet, no television, no parties, no music, none of this nonsense. Museum, college. In Yemen, everyone primitive. You want bread? You make bread like 2,000 years ago. You want to go to the market, you go with the donkey. There's nothing. No television, no cars, no nothing. No computer. You know, when we buy a trog for Sukkot, the best one is Yemenite trog. Everything else, it's maybe a trog, maybe lemon. We don't know. But Yemenite, 100% for sure it's a trog. Why? The Yemenite farmers are so primitive, they don't know how to mix the etrog with lemon. So we know for sure it's a trog. Everywhere else in the world, they mix it with lemon, that it looks nicer and it's easier to grow. But in Yemen, it's like 2,000 years ago. You put a trog come. They don't know how to mix. You understand? That's why the Jews, all of them stay religious. Everywhere else they came, business, cars, chandeliers, Persian rug, Goyish music, started to marry the Goyim. What happened? 50 years later, the Holocaust started. Pogrom in Russia, Holocaust in Germany. People think, it's coincidence. No, nothing is coincidence. You know, today, the number one cancer by women is what? Breast cancer. 1 out of 8. 1 out of 8. Do you understand what we're talking here about? From every 100 women walk in the street, 8 of them, chas v'chalila, will get breast cancer, and some of them will die from it if they don't catch it on the right time. Second cancer for women, the wound cancer. Third one, brain cancer. The three parts that the women make sins with the men, the breast, the wound, and the head, cancer goes over there. It doesn't go to the hand. Goes to the stomach sometimes, but very rarely. Goes to other parts of the body, yes. But the three parts that the sins are done with, number one in cancer. The men, number one cancer, where? Prostate cancer. Number two, brain cancer, tumors. Why? Coincidence? No, my friend. Hashem say, you want to live like an animal? I don't need you here. You want to be holy? I say in the Torah, you are my children, you have to be holy. Shabbat, modesty, everything that I say, you have to keep. You don't want to keep, I don't need you. Leading people to the lectures. If each one of you tonight wanted to bring 10 more people, you couldn't? Of course you could. But you didn't care. Why do you care? So they don't come. If a Jew goes to a lecture, he knows somebody is going to take a knife and stab it into the people and shake them, and maybe they wake up a little bit. How can you leave your brother, your sister, your uncle, your parents, whatever, and not drag them? And now people tell me, no, they don't listen to me. They think I'm crazy. But when he really wants something, he gets them to do it. But when it's not important, he doesn't care. So the idea, first of all, you have to know one thing. The Holocaust was not the Yetziat Mitzrayim and not Days of Mashiach. It was 5 years of punishments to many wicked people that Hashem gave. Now you have to remember also one thing. Just because a person has a beard or a woman has covered her face, you don't know who she was in her previous life. You don't know. So the answer is, not everyone who looks tzaddik is really tzaddik. Sometimes it's from previous life. And there are much more things that I can tell you, but there's no more time. Let's show the movie. I want to show the movie. I am showing you now a person, a Hasid, an Ashkenazi Jew, close to 60 years old, plus minus, who pray in Mincha, in Tfilat Mincha, which is short Tfilah. In Shachrit is much, much more dramatic. But in Shachrit it's impossible to film him because the place is packed. But Mincha, it's more quiet, so there is able to get the camera in. Please. No. This is every day, not Yom Kippur. It's all with tears, crying fully. Like these 15 years every day. דבוק בקדוש ברוך הוא. הוא בוכה על עם ישראל, בוכה על עם ישראל. Since his bar mitzvah is like this. Since his bar mitzvah. The pain of thousands of people who come to cry to him every day for the problem. The Monsi, the Ish Kadosh. Two more minutes. No, מישהו אחר. שמע ישראל. כן. טוב. You can turn back the light. There is a very interesting thing that I've seen throughout the years. There are people, maybe five or six of them participated in my lectures in the past, that are able to see spiritual souls that we cannot see. One time I was in a lecture in Queens, there was a woman sitting in a crowd, and then after the lecture she came to me and she started to say that while I was speaking, my grandmother was right above me. And she started to describe my grandmother. Now first I was sure that she's speaking about my righteous grandmother. I had a very righteous grandmother from my father's side. She was working in the house of the Chazonish. Not many women in the history had this merit. And the biggest rabbi in the world. She was doing the laundry over there and taking care of the house for a few years. She replaced her aunt after she got old. She got the job. It was very, very old days, like 50, 60 years ago, maybe more. And I was sure that if anyone, who's going to be above me? The righteous grandmother. But then she started to describe my Persian grandmother. When she was righteous in Iran, until they brought her to Israel, you know, with the influence of not such nice people in the neighborhood, she stopped keeping Shabbat, and she became, you know, half and half. She was traditional. Like they say in Hebrew, Masorti. What does it mean, Masorti, in Hebrew? In Hebrew, sword is Masor. So the word Masorti, it's a sword, a tea sword. Every day they cut another mitzvah off until nothing left. Then she described her exactly how she looks. Her curly hair, what outfit she's wearing. I got shocked. She sees everything. And how it happened to her, in her labor for her third kid, she died in the middle of the labor and she came back to life. And from that moment on, she got special powers. There's another one in Israel that drowned inside the mikveh. He had an attack inside the mikveh, he died. And after a few minutes, they revived him. And since that day, he started to have all kinds of special powers to see things. Just a few days ago, I'm getting a phone call. I'm not going to give you too many details because I don't want you to, you know, to do one and one. Because this person doesn't want, I'm sure, to be published. But I'm not going to tell you who it was. But there's somebody who complains that they're very frightening. Why? They see images all the time. And now this person is not a rabbi. He's not somebody who goes to yeshiva or Talmid Chacham, that he knows Kabbalah. But by the story, I saw that everything is 100% real. Unless if this person is more knowledgeable than many rabbis that we know, there's no other way to explain it. One of the things, I'm going to say they, because I don't want you to know if it's a man or woman. One of the things they say, they see, it's letters. Hebrew letters on the forehead of people. But this person doesn't understand Hebrew. But they know the letters, Aleph, Bet, Daled. So they can describe how the letters are, but they don't understand the meaning. One other thing this person sees is images of people all the time flying in space. As the Zohar said, there are people who are flying in space. One time they went to the Western Wall. Looking at the Western Wall, they see many, many faces of people, all kinds of people. Then they look at the hand of people and they see on the hands of people also letters of Aleph Bet. Very interesting. We say in the Tefillah, Poteach et Yadecha, we open up the hands like this. Letters, don't understand what. Then they see images that look half like people, half like animals. and that's demons. I once made a lecture, it's in my website, about demons. Exactly, they describe it. They don't know these things. At all. It's not that they learn the Ari and all these things to know how the demons look. Then they hear sometimes voices. Voices of people talking, and they don't understand Hebrew. So there are voices that they hear, all kinds of things.
Newspaper.
When they made the article about me in Hamodia, which is the most religious newspapers in the world, very strict, I sent them a picture of me speaking to a big audience in the auditorium. They did not put it in. Why? Far away, there's women sitting. Far away, you don't see anything. You see a little dot. You know, it's from far away. They don't put, because there's someone who checks everything. You send them a picture, they don't put every picture inside. They check what's in the picture. I told them, post my website in the article that people can go and learn Torah on the website. There's lots of shiurim. They did not put. I told them the story about how we opened TorahAnytime.com, me and my two talmidim together, when we opened it. I was the first one there. As soon as the TorahAnytime.com, it's already out of the article. Why? They do not want to even hint to an internet. Why? Because they have supervisor who watch every word that is put in the newspaper. Nothing. Many of the things I told them in the interview did not make it. I said I was a speaker. I used to use the overhead projector until my friend Ginsberger got me a laptop and forced me to become more advanced. That part came out of the article. Why? Because a part of it was the word laptop. You understand? There's people who watch what you put. Not like the secular newspaper. You can slaughter a person and destroy this family reputation for the rest of their life and nobody makes a beep. You know what? It's funny. Because when they make that video against me, they collected all kinds of things that I say. So one of my fans, he admired the video. He said, wow, everything is 100% true. So he put it on his Facebook, the best of Rabbi Mizrachi. He didn't know. They make it to make fun at me. So he put it for us. What a great video. How two people can look at the same video and say, ah, Divrei Elokim Chaim and this Amalek. They said, Amalek, Zera Amalek. I tell you the truth, today I had an intention to say the name of the girl that opened this whole thing. But I know that once I'll do it, her life will be miserable. She will suffer for the next 30 years. Why? Because I already have people who send me, just tell me. And I will take care of her that she'll never, ever forget.
Who she is.
I know, she says who she is, but if I say it in my lecture to my followers, you don't have to imagine how her life's going to turn, to what kind of life she's going to have. You understand? Because you have people that they're very devoted. You know, there's a person saved their life, who took them from what they were, and is religious, they're willing to do everything for him. You know, there are people like this. So imagine if you just mention it. I remember, I'll tell you a story, and we'll finish with that. I remember 15 years ago, I went to give a lecture in Brooklyn, and who was there? The head of the crime world in Israel, the biggest criminal in the history of Israel. His whole body is tattoos, all face scars, the murders, drug dealing, mafia, collection, was in jail in Italy, robbing boats in the middle of the ocean. I never saw such thing. Just you look at the person. He told me a story one time. He went to Manhattan to buy his girlfriend a jewel. The Korean guy, as soon as he walked in, take for free. Take. He said, well, what do you mean? I want to pay you. No, I don't want money. Take. Just from looking at him. So anyway, one time he accidentally came to my lecture with his brother. His brother is okay person, not a criminal. He brought him to the shiur, and then he woke up and he started to do tshuva and he became religious. Really religious, but really religious. So one time he saw someone did something to me, he called him up. He said to him in Hebrew, Tishma, imata. לא מבקש עכשיו סליחה מהרב מזרחי, אני בא עכשיו לתגן אותך במחוות. Translation. He told him first who he is, and that person right away, as soon as he heard the voice, already fainted. He said, if you don't apologize right now, I come right now to your house, and I will cook you in the pot. I will fry you in a pot, not cook you, fry you. Or maybe you prepare, I will drown you in a mikveh. I had to beg him, relax, relax, don't worry. It was like fire. There are people like this. This is not our way. But it's very sad that people lose their olam haba because they're stupid. I know a guy, I tell you, I give you a story. When there is a shiur Torah, every Jew must understand there's no permission to even sneeze. Not to make a beep. If you make noise in the time of Shiur Torah, that means you disrespect Hashem. If I was here to come to read to you a letter from Obama, and CNN camera would be here to film the people, would you dare to talk in front of the camera when they read the words of Obama? The whole world would know that you disrespect the president. He's more important than HaKadosh Baruch Hu. Here, no, I'm talking, and they continue over there. Baruch Hashem. All right. I was about to tell a story, but I already forgot what I wanted to say.
But the person gave you money probably.
3 years he didn't sleep.
Oh, I tell you what. Here, maybe a little bit. L'chaim. Let me tell you a story that happened one time. One time I brought a guy to the yeshiva, and the guy is sitting in the yeshiva almost a month already. One Israeli guy who was working for real estate. Then after a month, he comes to me, this guy. He said to me, I have to leave the yeshiva. I told him, why? You're doing so well. You became Shomer Shabbat. You do so many wonderful things. How in your mind you want to leave the yeshiva now? So he said to me, not that I want to leave. I have no choice. My boss in the office is driving me crazy. I owe him money. He gave me some advance money on deals. And the deal didn't close yet. And he keeps calling me. What about the $2,000? It wasn't even $2,000. It was less than that. So I told him, leave it to me. Give me your boss number. Let me call him. I call up his boss. I tell his boss, I'm about to give you an offer that you cannot refuse. You know, this guy David, is your worker, he works for you, and he owes you some money, and you deserve to get your money, it's your money. But I'm willing to make a deal that you forgive your money. You let him keep the money. He's going to stay thanks to it in yeshiva probably for years, because he's a very smart, clever, tzaddik guy. He's going to learn Torah for years. Every minute is 1,000 mitzvot to learn Torah. Every minute. 1,000 mitzvot. Multiply by 10 hours a day that the yeshiva bachur learns, it's 600,000 mitzvot a day. And I'm explaining it to him. Multiply it by 6 days a week, 3 million mitzvot a week, 12 million mitzvot a month. It's going to be in yeshiva at least a year. You're going to make half of his mitzvot. You're going to make tens of millions of mitzvot for $2,000. Yeah. Nobody in history made a deal like this since the day Hashem created the world until now, I told him. So let him go. Tell him that you forgive him the money. Don't worry. If one day you go back to business, I'm sure he's going to return it to you. Look how it bothers him that he owes you the money. I would do it. I understand what you say, but I myself in problem. You know, I'm very tight right now. 1 week I'm trying to convince him to give up the money, and I don't know who the guy is. He presents himself a very, very miserable, poor guy. He did not give up. He got that guy out of the yeshiva. A month later, the guy became a Mechalel Shabbat, 100% goy. And then I found out that this guy has millions of dollars in properties. Millions of dollars he owned. This Rasha Merusha, Shem Reshaim Irkav. He messed up a whole mishpacha now. This guy would stay in yeshiva. He will get married to a religious girl. They'll have 7, 8 kids. They'll have 50 grandkids. They'll have 150 grandchildren. They all will be Shomer Shabbat. He murdered all of them. For $2,000, I can put my life on the line that a month later he already lost it in a different deal. Do you think that by being stingy with Hashem you make money? If I can only see the face of this guy. I never saw him face to face. I only spoke to him on the phone a few times. And the person has millions of dollars. Not that he's an employee. He owns the office. He was fooling me all along. And he got the guy out of the yeshiva. You understand what does it mean? People don't give up. When it comes to money, they murder. Why? That's it. It's a sickness.
No, okay.
Today, someone called me from Mexico. He told me, I want to bring you to Mexico. I've been listening to you for 3 years. Every day, I have all my friends. They're all listening. I want you to come to Mexico. I said to him, I don't want to come. I said, I'm tired of the politics. Tired of the politics. You can speak here, you cannot speak there. Don't be strict, don't be this. Enough with this nonsense. You want to listen to me, here's my address. Tell your friend, this is my lecture, come and listen. No, you cannot speak here because the board, the five people that are Mechalele Shabbat, and they make money from stealing, they decide who is going to speak the words of Hashem and who is not. Who is allowed to speak about the modesty? Not here, because our wives are not modest. He's going to intimidate us. We cannot allow him here. It's not suitable for our community. I never knew this different Torah for different communities. I never knew.
Rabbi, unfortunately, it's true. You call any organization, you want to bring a speaker that's going to be honest, they want to first investigate how is it going to come.
100%. 100%. You know, I tell you something. I spoke in a place, and they say to me, would you come again? I say yes. So after the second time, they say to me, no, somebody from the board here doesn't want. So I say, you know what? It's okay. You have another good speaker, Rabbi Wallerstein. Call him. So they say to me, oh. So I gave him a list of few speakers who say the truth. All of those speakers on the band. Only speaker who tell jokes are welcome. And tell how great you are. People who say, you're not allowed to be Mechalel Shabbat, you're not allowed to dance Zumba, you're not allowed to walk naked, you're not allowed to go into filthy places in the internet, they're not welcome here. Only people would say to the sinners, you are great, we love them. People who tell you, hey, wake up, my friend. One person wrote against me today, I heard, if he preached to us against internet and Facebook, how come he has a Facebook page? What a fool. What kind of Facebook page I have? All lectures of Torah and articles about the parasha and Musar and things. I don't have one member friend personal there. Nothing, no news, no nothing. Only 100% from day one Torah. Why we opened it? For losers like you, maybe you do tshuva. Why? Because to invite you to my lecture, you won't come. So I have to come to your filthy area to save you from the mud. Not for you to make criticism. Once people have no brain. I'm interested to waste my time on this garbage and to sit and write articles and to post lectures. Maybe some fools would finally make tshuva. What is this? When you want to go against someone, everything is kosher. The truth, it's another thing. Bezrat Hashem, we'll see you next Tuesday.